many people are not aware of how to properly load a dishwasher. And it was just, it warmed my feminist heart to see three men crowded around a dishwasher at 2 a.m. debating how dishwashers function and how to clean those dishes most effectively. Thank you. Keep it up.
I would be more honored if I remembered any of this happening.
Well, let me jog your memory. You were dressed like Mary Poppins.
Yeah.
We were listening to Nickelback.
Oh,
we were
yeah.
drinking pickle juice.
Mixed with whiskey. It wasn't the pickleback. It was pickle juice and whiskey. The same. It was a highball.
Sounds like a bad country song. You're dressed as Mary Poppins, drinking pickle juice and whiskey, and you're trying to load the dishwasher all wrong.
Welcome to Pod Keep Our Land. It's what?
Emily Murphy.
Would have listened to. I'm Erin Rennie.
And I'm Matthew Naylor.
And it is October 19th? 18th?
Yes. My watch says the 18th, but it's the 19th.
It's the 19th. Day long, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. All right. Okay, no, I'm not going to do the watch thing now.
But. October 19th, 2017. It's just the two of us today. Our friend Patrick Meehan couldn't make it today, unfortunately. But he'll be back on our next episode. So we'll try to persevere. I have a feeling, Matthew, that if I know our friendship, mm-hmm. this conversation is very likely to be very dry and very silly.
Yeah, no, that's...
That's my prediction for today.
It's
basically
the Canada Dry of conversations.
So silly. Okay, so what are we going to talk about today? We have a whole bunch of news we want to update you on. Then we wanted to spend some time talking about Bill 62. That's the Quebec face veil ban. We're going to spend some time talking about the future of fish farms here in British Columbia. And then we'll have Matthew's interview with Hector Bremner, newest city councillor in the city of Vancouver.
I sat down with him tomorrow.
Correct. Time traveling podcast.
Stop the podcast. Actually, what we're going to do is, because Erin and I recorded well over time, is give you a bonus podcast. So today you're going to be hearing about a couple of news items, Personal Stay in the Me Too campaign, and the Bill C-62 face covering ban. And then on Monday or Tuesday of next week, you will hear about some of the NDP legislative support actions, the results of the Vancouver by-election, fish farms, and my interview with Hector Bremner, which will also give me a chance to edit that interview. Anyway, thanks for your patience, and hope you enjoy the rest of these shows.
So we are Pod Keep Our Land. We're a show about Canadian politics, parliaments, politicians, and policy. And we are coming at you not live from Vancouver.
Quite dead in the spirit of the season.
Yes, it is very, very wet outside, and you may be able to hear the trucks driving by through the giant puddles on my street. So enjoy.
We're in the satellite studio today.
That's right. Yeah, we decided to change locations, so that might indicate, or that might be why sound is different this time.
Mm-hmm.
But it just provides more atmosphere.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
For
atmosphere at like 100% humidity.
There you go. So lots of things have happened this week, Matthew. Sad news.
Yes. Bill Morneau. No, I woke up when I saw that Gord Downie had passed away, and that was very sad. And while everyone knew that it was coming, it was still sad to experience it. I don't know about you, but I went through a kind of grieving process when he first announced that he had incurable cancer.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad that they gave us a chance to say goodbye.
Yeah, I agree. That's a good point. Yeah, so, of course, Gord Downie, frontman for the Tragically Hip, one of Canada's most beloved rock bands, passed away this week at the age of 3. Gord Downie's given us some of our most iconic, memorable songs that we grew up listening to, beautiful poetry, and you know, I was thinking about it, like, what a patriot.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't often call Canadians patriots. It's not really a thing, but like, he was so patriotic.
Yeah.
So just in love with Canada.
And like, CanCon as a concept allows the occasional person like that to come forward, but I think that, you know, to support them on their way up, but Like, he embraced that, and, like, the thing that I find really remarkable about him is that he didn't go outside of Canada and try and become globally famous. Like,
mm-hmm.
Avril and Justin Bieber and, you know, Bryan Adams and Neil Young are global sensations. Like, we export a lot of culture, but they don't reflect our culture back to us, and they don't write about us in a way that I think we often lack.
Right,
and
yeah.
I think that Gord Downie and other people mm-hmm. like Stan Rogers and Gordon Lightfoot have done more of that.
Yeah, told us our story.
Yeah.
So we hope you're all listening to lots of wonderful, tragically hip music and reading the lyrics and remembering what Gord Downie has done for Canada, not just as a musician, but as an advocate and just a wonderful Canadian.
Mm-hmm. And staunch Liberal Party of Canada supporter.
Speaking of the Liberal Party.
Yes. Sadly for Bill Morneau.
Bill Morneau, finance minister, things are happening to you. Bill Morneau is he's not a lifelong politician. He's new to politics.
Yeah, this last election was his foray into Canadian politics, which, like, I think goes a long way to show how good the Liberal Party's candidate recruitment was. Like, they put a lot of effort into finding some, like, quality, top-notch people to run, but that also means that they have found a bunch of people who have never done this before, and maybe weren't entirely equipped for the, like, very bright lights of the Ottawa press corps.
Right. So things are a little different when you're in public life,
mm-hmm.
And you're trying to defend, say, a piece of legislation to close tax loopholes.
But not the tax loopholes that you enjoy.
Right. So our friend, the Minister of Finance, turns out has all sorts of assets that don't make the tax reform bill look very good.
No, which is a shame, because, like, I support the tax reform bill, but maybe there should be more tax reforms.
Right. That would be one approach to it. So we'll probably get more into this next week, but
mm-hmm.
Just wanted to mention that.
Had a very terrible, no good, very bad week.
Yeah, it's a tough one. Another Liberal Party, BC Liberal Party, continuing their star search for a leadership person, a leader,
mm-hmm.
a leadership person, a leader.
Mike, and the others.
So everybody who wants to be the leader of the BC Liberals
mm-hmm.
had a debate.
Yes.
I did not watch it, did you?
I watched part of it. It has a ton of people up on stage, and they have got to work on the format, because it was tough to watch. But,
yeah.
Like, it was, and now you all have 90 seconds to say a thing, and you have 30 seconds to respond. And I went down the line, and I went back down the line, and, ugh. Yeah, it was a little brutal. Although, like, clearly Platitude Boot Camp has been playing off, because all of them have their sound bites, like, well in hand, and I have absolutely no idea what any of them stands for, except for possibly Mike DeYoung, who, like, admirably defended his record as finance minister by saying, you know, people always gripe about me being a, you know, that tightwad DeYoung, and I think he does make a case for, like, the direction that they were headed, and I don't necessarily agree with it in retrospect, but I think that it is admirable, and the role of a finance minister to keep spending under control. It is the role of the other ministers to spend it.
Right,
yes.
Right. So when you say the direction, you're talking about the whole balanced budget thing that BC Liberals have sort of made as one of their core values.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Michael Lee was interesting. You know, he's a newcomer to the party. And Diane Watts was all right, but I think needs to step it up a little bit if she, like, I don't know. She spoke in a lot of, like, of the people who went heavy on the platitude, she was probably the worst of the bunch there.
Hmm. Okay. So several more debates coming up.
Mm-hmm. But one less Mike. Because,
one less Mike.
Yes. Mike Bernier has dropped out.
Oh.
Yes.
Do we know why?
I think it's because I think there must have been an internal campaign decision that they just weren't picking up as much momentum as they wanted.
Yeah.
And I'm really hoping that this continues to happen and more candidates drop out, because that debate was brutal and almost unwatchable. So I would like to get a better idea of where these candidates stand on the issues, on where they want to take the party, how they want to win back power and win back the respect of the people.
Right.
And, you know, Sam Sullivan's very, very funny jokes aside, and, you know, he was a delight to watch. I need a little more time with the candidates, and I need to get them to get into some, like, one-on-one clash to really see how they differentiate themselves from one another.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll continue to check in on the BC Liberal leadership race. So, Matthew, yesterday was a very important day in Canadian history.
Yes.
Person's Day.
It was. So, happy Person's Day.
Thank you. Happy Person's Day to you, too.
Thank you.
It's been 88 years since women have been officially persons. White women, I should note.
Mm-hmm.
Not all women were acknowledged to be persons in the person's case. Do you remember the person's case?
Well, I wasn't alive at the time.
No,
but
no. You're not 108 years old. So the person's case, I'm going to tell it to you.
Yeah.
BC, 1920s-ish.
Mm-hmm.
A woman called Emily Murphy is a judge.
Yes.
And she, there's a case in front of her.
Mm-hmm.
And the loser of the case doesn't like the results. And he argues that the case is invalid because she is not a person, even though she is a judge and clearly a human adult.
Mm-hmm.
So this goes on and on and on and on.
Mm-hmm.
And it creates, and it leads to this whole campaign, Famous Five, all these women fighting to be declared persons in Canada. And because it's in the 1920s, it doesn't stop at the Canadian borders.
It goes all the way to the Supreme Court, where it failed.
Right.
Yes.
And then what happened?
And then it went to the JCPC, or Judicial Committee of the Privy Council, which is a committee of the British government where the law lords preside.
The law lords?
The law lords.
The law lords of the British Empire.
Yes.
And what did they say?
They said that women were, in fact, persons in Canada and possibly everywhere. It's I actually don't know the impact empire-wide, although the British were never too shy about differentiating between their colonies.
Sure, yeah.
But it meant that, as the Heritage Minute said, women can sit in the Senate after all.
I mean, we laugh, but this is really serious.
It is really serious.
Like, can you imagine being a judge, having gone to school and worked as a lawyer for that long, and then to have your case thrown out because you're not a person in the empire where you reside?
I think
it's
that...
It's extraordinary.
I said I didn't remember it, but, like, I grew up in Alberta, and Alberta thinks a lot about Nellie McClung, who's another member of this, of the Famous Five, and she had the Parliament of Women in Manitoba, where she presided over a chamber debating whether or not men should be granted the vote, which I think was delightful.
Mm-hmm.
But it's an important thing to remember that, like, we have come very far in, like, quite a short amount of time, and also progress is very fragile and need to be safeguarded against.
Right. 88 years is not a long time.
No, and, you know, a significantly shorter amount of time for many other types of women and people in Canada.
Right. Yeah. So Indigenous women in Canada.
1960,
they were granted the right to vote in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
Our parents would have been alive at that time.
Yeah, my grandmother was one of those people.
Right.
And, you know, the after effects of Japanese internment rolled on well into the 1950s. I think people were allowed to return to their homes, which had already been taken away from them and sold, years afterwards.
Uh-huh.
It was abhorrent, and we have to keep reminding ourselves that we're still doing stuff like this.
That's right.
The person's case is a landmark case, and we continue to have interesting landmark cases at the Supreme Court that I think have in general made the country better. So let us celebrate progress.
Yeah.
Judicial supremacy.
Just thinking about the person's case, it just always fills me with feminist rage. And I know a lot of us have been feeling a lot of feminist rage this week as well, because in addition to all the other things we've talked about, sweeping the social media is #MeToo.
Yes.
Like crazy, like bonkers.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to be having a huge impact on people.
Yeah, I think it's had an impact on me. And, you know, I think my role as a man is to sit quietly and listen to people. And I just want to say thank you for sharing your story if you have shared it. And I appreciate the courage in your having done so.
Nice. Yeah. So, of course, #MeToo is this social media campaign asking anybody who's ever experienced sexual assault or sexual harassment to just express that has happened to them by hashtagging #MeToo. And interesting to note that this campaign was actually started 10 years ago by a woman of color in the United United States, but it's sort of been, I don't know, reinvented or revived by, after this, what's his name? Harvey
Harvey Weinstein. But wait, there were hashtags 10 years ago? Well, I guess there were. Twitter was around. Man, I feel old now. Oh, geez. Oh, we're into the second decade of hashtags. Oh, man. Sorry, I just had to take a break there for a little existential crisis.
Time. Okay. What is it? Anyway. So hashtag me too. We'd be interested to hear about how that's impacting you. Is that, I had a very interesting conversation with my own family at the dinner table around sexual harassment and whether catcalling was a compliment or not. And it was a really interesting conversation to hear, you know, the perspective from my grandmother and my brothers and everybody of different generations, sort of provided an opportunity for us to dig into that conversation that we wouldn't have done otherwise.
Yeah, I think that, like, the greatest part about this new, I don't know if it's a wave of feminism yet, but, like, there seems to be, it seems to be being discussed a lot more in the public consciousness than it has been in the past decade or two.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, it's the greatest amount of discussion that I think we've had about feminist issues at any point that I've been alive, or at least politically conscious.
Yeah.
Which is good.
Yes.
Because feminism is about making everyone's lives better.
Right. And it's helping us to sort of reveal harmful forms of oppression that has sort of been swept under the rug.
Mm-hmm.
Just thinking about this case in Hollywood where this person was assaulting, harassing people and not being held accountable for decades.
Mm-hmm.
And
there were jokes about it. There were jokes on 30 Rock and, like, game shows about Harvey Weinstein was a sexual predator, basically. And it also really, like, retrospectively tinges Bill Clinton's legacy because, like, these things happened and no one really talked about it that much. I mean, of course they talked about it quite a bit because of the Monica Lewinsky events, but, like, it really shows how much the culture has changed, that what people kind of poo-pooed is, like, oh, it's not important, he's just a, you know, good old Southern boy.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you look back on it and you think, one, how could I think that, and two,
well put. We've really seen, just even in our own lifetimes, a real radical change when it comes to
mm-hmm.
this sort of, I don't want to say identity politics because that doesn't have a very good connotation right now, but like
cultural consciousness.
Yeah, cultural consciousness, and that is very political because it is about who has power in our society.
Mm-hmm.
Matthew,
Erin,
governments.
So I thought we were doing an improv thing.
No. Governments, it seems, are forever trying to decide what women should wear on their bodies.
Mm-hmm.
They are very preoccupied with this, strangely, don't you think?
Yeah. It's a lot of work that goes into the deciding of what women should wear on their bodies, in their bodies, do with their bodies, time that possibly could be spent better doing other things.
Maybe.
And not deciding things that men get to decide for themselves.
Yes. For example, last week, the Quebec National Assembly adopted into law Bill 62, which bans face coverings for anyone giving or receiving public services, including municipal services.
Mm-hmm.
While the bill does not mention the niqab or the burqa specifically, it would effectively prohibit Muslim women who wear those garments from doing things like attending university or school, going to a hospital, riding the bus, holding a job as a government worker, doctor, dentist, midwife,
I mean, like,
et cetera.
How far does this, are they not gonna connect sewer lines to Muslim women's houses? Are they not, like, this is insane. And the fact that the guidelines might come out next year is very bad.
Right.
The fact that there are guidelines at all is very bad. But the fact that there aren't guidelines and won't be for this entire year leaves it up to the discretion of municipal police forces. And that seems like a recipe for catastrophe.
People are going to get hurt.
Yeah, yes, they are. Like,
yes.
Very soon.
Yes.
And it's been very bad in France when they've been trying this, and it has created monstrous backlash and, you know, a ton of, like, absolutely justifiable anger that, you know, some people have claimed has sometimes been channeled into homegrown extremism, which, you know, that connection may be tenuous or might be direct, but, like, passing laws that oppress a particular group is really really good way to make that particular group more angry at you.
Yeah, and of course, the Quebec National Assembly government, the provincial government in Quebec, says that this isn't about targeting a specific group. It's not about religion.
No, it's about banning the devil's holiday, Halloween. By the way, masks are banned now. Like, can't ride the bus on Halloween if you're wearing a mask, according to this law.
Well, yeah, that's how I would interpret this.
Mm-hmm.
The same with things like goggles or, like a helmet if you were a police officer riding a motorcycle, for example. It's very confusing. But at the same time, the government's, like, this isn't an isolated incident. This, you know, France has been talking about this for a very long time. I remember this being a national debate in France in, like, 2006.
Yeah.
And all of this debate around, you know, the wearing of religious symbols seems to be about head coverings for Muslim women.
Yeah, it's xenophobia masquerading as French secularism. But this isn't the Dreyfus Affair, and this isn't, like, them trying to purge Quebec or France of the influences of the Catholic Church. This is about them trying to oppress a minority. Like, they're not trying to throw off the shackles of, like, Catholic domination of the province. Like, this isn't the Quiet Revolution all over again.
Mm-hmm.
This is an empowered Franco majority saying your kind is not welcome here.
Right. And not surprisingly, the rest of Canada and a lot of people in Quebec, a lot of people in Montreal have come out and said this is just completely unheard of. This is not Canadian. This is not how we treat each other. And
Denis Coderre, for example, the mayor of Montreal, has come up very strongly against this.
Right. And of course, the Quebec government says, well, we're going to have religious accommodation. You can apply for an exemption if you have, like, a good religious reason why you can't comply with this law. But like you said, the guidelines around that are not going to be available until July. But the law went into effect this week.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody who wears a face covering for religious reasons, and those reasons are important to them, they're not going to stop.
Yeah, like, if someone wants to wear a bridal veil and use their municipal hall, they can't.
Right, yeah, good point. And so there's all of these different kinds of scenarios that this law might create, and I'm just like, it must be bonkers to be a public servant right now in Quebec.
This was not well thought through. Like, for one thing, why did the law have to go into effect today? Like, or the day it was enacted. That seems insane and very bad. We shouldn't have had to rush in. Like, obviously it is going to create a charter challenge issue, and I certainly hope it's found unconstitutional. I think it certainly ticks a lot of the boxes that would indicate that it would be, but in the meantime, it's going to be very crappy for a bunch of people for a while.
Mm-hmm. And that's not fair.
No, it is not.
And so I want to talk about the politics of this a little bit, because it does seem extraordinary. It seems very unreasonable. It seems pretty clear that this is headed for a Supreme Court charter challenge.
Oh, yeah.
And although the Quebec government has said that that they drafted this legislation so that it will be consistent with the charter, not a lot of agreement around that from the experts that we've heard from so far. And
no party has covered themselves in glory here. Like, the two parties that voted against the bill voted, like, the Parti Québécois and the Coalition d'Avenir du Québec, or Coalition for Quebec's Future,
mm-hmm.
voted against it because it was not discriminatory enough.
Yeah, didn't go far enough.
Yeah.
Right. Like, and this was an election promise that the government ran on.
Yes.
In response to the other parties, and their, do you remember what it was?
Sorry, the racism was the term?
No. There was some kind of, like, values document.
Oh, yeah, the Quebec Charter of Values.
Right.
Which theoretically did similar types of things to preserve Quebec secular identity, which definitely rings true because of the huge crucifix that's hanging in the National Assembly.
Right. So here's what I'm wondering. Philippe Couillard, Premier of Quebec, did he put this forward so that it could immediately get shot down by a charter challenge, so that it would rule out the possibility of having to do something like this, allowing him to run on on it, win, and follow up on an election promise, and then let the Supreme Court be the bad guys in this scenario and sort of put the issue aside? That's kind of what I'm wondering.
That is some multidimensional chess there. And like,
don't buy it?
Yeah, maybe. I mean, he's drafted it in such a way that it will cause problems almost immediately.
Right, yeah. Why would you do that?
Yeah, and when is the next Quebec election?
Why, it's October 1st, 2018. Just under a year from now.
Yep. Huh. Interesting.
Right. So that's one theory, that, you know, they're just trying to get this issue addressed, I'm using air quotes here, shot down by another, senior government jurisdiction, and then, or the courts, rather, and then they can move on from this.
Yeah. And that's certainly possible, although I think that's playing a very dangerous game with legislation, because what if something crazy happens and the Supreme Court is like, yep, totally passed muster.
Yeah,
racism's cool now.
Right.
Which would be terrible and probably unlikely, but you know, at least Philippe Card can run on the fact that he did, you know, I was discriminatory enough. Bad Supreme Court said we couldn't.
Mm-hmm.
But it's very, very disappointing.
What do you think the federal government's going to do, federal parties?
Well, Jagmeet Singh has, unsurprisingly, come out and condemned this already, to his credit.
Yeah.
Justin Trudeau says that it is not the place of the federal government to get involved in provincial matters, which has been the practice recently. Although, if you want to poli-sci geek out for a second.
Do I?
There are the powers. Dead powers, probably, of reservation and disallowance.
Ooh, dead powers!
So, in the spirit of the season, Justin Trudeau might resurrect the power of disallowance to say that a provincial law is unconstitutional and cannot go into force. The last time they did this was in 1943, when the government of William Lyon Mackenzie King said that Alberta's social credit government's law that restricted land sales to Hutterites and enemy aliens was illegal. Which, funnily enough, kind of the same thing, basically.
Hmm.
It's discriminating against a outsider group with unusual styles of dress that make people feel uncomfortable for whatever reason. Maybe it's time to dust off those constitutional history books. There, Minister Wilson Raybould.
Mm-hmm.
This is super novel and it's not going to happen, but...
I don't know if I see a Trudeau prime minister trying to tell the Quebec government what they should be doing 2 years before a federal election.
Yeah, no, probably not. But not like the Trudeau name has ever been associated with imposing their will upon Quebec. Well, I think that's time.
One more question.
Yeah.
What have the Tories said on this? Have they said anything?
Ultimately, it's up to Quebecers to pass judgment on this legislation. The Conservative Party believes every Canadian has the right to express themselves and practice their religion, not just in private, but in public too, said Jake Enright, Director of Communications for Conservative leader Andrew Scheer.
Okay, so basically the same thing the Prime Minister said, or the same position.
Yeah, I mean, but it's not up to Quebecers to pass judgment on this legislation. It's like subject to the Constitution, which is, I think, different from what the Prime Minister has said. It's not up to the federal government to challenge this, and it's not really, at least under the current conception of how charter challenges program works.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it's they're always very careful about dancing around full respect for the National Assembly of Quebec, and it is important for the federal government to respect provincial jurisdictions, but...
I don't think they're going to have to, honestly.
No.
Like, I think there are enough angry people in Quebec right now.
Yeah, that's true.
A lot of them are Muslim women who were born and raised in Quebec,
mm-hmm.
and are feeling pretty unhappy about this law, and I don't think they're going to stand for it. So I'm sure we're going to see lots of movement on this story,
mm-hmm.
and maybe we can provide an update in her podcast.
Yeah, absolutely.
Want to add anything else?
Nope.
Good. Okay, so what I've been thinking about this week, speaking of the UN and feminist rage, last week was the UN Day of the Girl, Day of the Girl Child, to give it the full name of the day. And this is the day where we think about girls all over the world. The theme this year was girls' access to education. And anyway, I know this is sounding really political, but it's actually about pop culture, because Beyoncé wrote an amazing song and put together this amazing video featuring girls all over the world. dancing to her music, and it's called Freedom for Girls, and it's just, like, so inspiring, and I tear up every time I watch it, and it's just so awesome to, like, to see a big star like Beyonce getting on board for such an important issue as empowering girls to access around the world.
You know that the word girl used to just mean child?
Really?
Yeah, and so boy children were knave girls, and female children were gay girls.
I have never heard that before.
This is something that I'm repeating from QI, so probably true.
Like in the Middle Ages, or
yeah,
okay,
yeah. Well,
okay.
No, not the Middle Ages. A little later than that, but like early modern English for sure. Yeah. Also, pink used to be the boys' color,
right?
And blue was the girls' color because it was the color of the Virgin Mary.
Sure. Yeah.
And also, all those assignments are very
yeah. Colors are for everyone.
Yes.
What have you been
doing? I've been thinking a lot about Canadian music. You know, Gord Downie's passing was tragic and sad, and it particularly got me thinking of another tragic and sad passing of another Canadian troubadour, Stan Rogers, who died in the early 80s when his plane, it was a flight that was going from Dallas to Toronto, and it had to land in Cleveland. The plane had filled with smoke, and about half of the people got off, and then the smoke flashed over, and everyone else was burned to death, and he was 33 years old, and which, like, surprised me when I learned about it, because he went quite a bit older than 33. But we got so many wonderful songs about out of him that it just makes me think, like, what if he was able to continue writing for another 20, 30 years? And I think that's been a great tragedy that we've lost him, but I think that he's contributed a huge amount to the Canadian musical canon, and now we've lost another great Canadian artist, so.
Rogers. Yes, he has definitely made a few late night parties and evenings on transit.
Yeah, but the song that I was thinking of mostly was The Giant, because it's just a sad and a melancholic song about a giant, and you should listen to it.
Okay, yeah. So thinking about Gord Downie, thinking about Stan Rogers, thinking about girls around the world, I think that's all we've got for you tonight on Pod Keep Our Land. My name's Erin Redding.
I'm Matthew Naylor.
Thank you for listening. If you liked what you heard, be sure to tune in every 2 weeks. We have a new episode. You can find out when our episodes are fresh by following us on Facebook and Twitter. You can also subscribe to our podcast wherever you get your podcasts. And if you like this episode, please share it. We want to make sure that we're reaching the broadest audience possible. So do share this episode around and let us know if you liked it. And we'll talk to you in a couple of weeks. Thanks, bye.
Bye.